Let the Bodies Hit the Floor. World Wrestling Federation presents SummerSlam 2001, taking place on August 19th, 2001, from the Compaq Center in San Jose, California. The attendance for this show was a sellout 15,293, 14,087 of which paid. The live gate for this show was $907,105, and the pay-per-view buys were $565,000. Compared to SummerSlam 2000, 2001 was lower in all three metrics, attendance, live gate, and pay-per-view buys. And compared to the rest of the WWF pay-per-views in 2001, SummerSlam was sixth lowest in attendance, with Survivor Series being the lowest. SummerSlam was third highest in live gate, with WrestleMania 17 being the highest. And SummerSlam was fifth highest in pay-per-view buys, with WrestleMania 17 being the highest. Your commentators for the night were Jim Ross and Paul Heyman, and in your Sunday Night Heat pre-show match, Jacqueline, Molly Holly, and Lita of the WWF defeated Stacy Keibler, Tori Wilson, and Ivory of the Alliance. Yes, SummerSlam 2001 is the Invasion SummerSlam. Every match on the night except for one was WWF versus the Alliance. And the opening match for SummerSlam 2001 was the first of six championship matches on the night. This one was for the World Wrestling Federation Intercontinental Championship. Champion Lance Storm of the Alliance versus Challenger Edge of the WWF. Lance Storm was in his first reign as Intercontinental Champion, defeating Albert on the July 23, 2001 episode of Raw. The bulk of the stories on this night are mostly just WWF versus the Alliance, with some other things here and there. This one was all about the Intercontinental Championship and Edge trying to bring the belt back to the WWF. Really solid opening match between Edge and Storm, and what else do you expect when you have a match between these two? Christian tried coming in to help Edge. He nearly cost him the match after he accidentally speared him. Edge came back too, as well as the referee. Edge and Storm tried hitting a move on each other. After many counters, Edge hit the Execution DDT for the pin. Post-match, Christian handed Edge the Intercontinental title. Later on, we got some teases of jealousy from Christian after a phone call, as Edge defeated Lance Storm in 11 minutes, 16 seconds, to win the WWF Intercontinental Championship. Match number two was a six-man tag team match. The Dudley Boys and Test of the Alliance versus the APA and Spike Dudley of the WWF. This is a continuation of Bubba and Devon feuding with their brother Spike, but added stuff because Invasion. The APA didn't trust Test due to his friendship with WCW owner Shane McMahon. Test would then cost the APA their WWF tag team titles to DDP and Canyon and defected to the Alliance. The result of that was a six-man tag team match added for SummerSlam. What you get here is a decent six-man tag match. Not great, but not terrible either. It accomplished what it needed to. Spike gets thrown around all match with some hope spots here and there. Eventually, he gets thrown through a table as the referee is checking on him. Shane runs down, hit Bradshaw with a chair. Test got the pin and the win as the Dudley Boys and Test defeated the APA and Spike Dudley in 7 minutes, 18 seconds. Match number 3 was the only match on SummerSlam 2001 that wasn't WWF versus the Alliance. This one here was the second of six championship matches on the night, and it was the first of two championship matches that were for two titles. This one was for the WWF Light Heavyweight and WCW Cruiserweight Championships. Light Heavyweight Champion Tajiri versus Cruiserweight Champion X-Pac. Tajiri was in his first Light Heavyweight title reign, while X-Pac was in his second Cruiserweight title reign. In the build-up for this match, X-Pac was both Light Heavyweight and Cruiserweight Champions. Then 13 days before SummerSlam, Tajiri won the Light Heavyweight Championship. Here you have a match for both belts. They called these double title matches on this show unification matches, which wasn't true at all because both belts were defended separately still after this. As far as the match went, it was a good match between X-Pac and Tajiri. Albert came out from the back to try and help X-Pac. He got missed to the face. X-Pac hit Tajiri with the X-Factor to finish the match, as X-Pac defeated Tajiri in 7 minutes, 33 seconds to retain the WCW Cruiserweight Championship and win the WWF Light Heavyweight Championship, making history as X-Pac would be the final WWF Light Heavyweight Champion. Now back to WWF versus the Alliance, and match number 4 was Chris Jericho of the WWF versus Rhino of the Alliance. This was the next chapter in the Jericho-Stephanie feud that had been going on for over a year at this point. Ever since the formation of the Alliance, Rhino had become Stephanie's muscle. You had the famous moment in the build of Rhino giving Jericho the gore through the SmackDown Ovaltron. That led to the creation of the SmackDown Fist set right around the same time. You also had the segment of Jericho insulting both Rhino and Stephanie. Let the bodies hit the floor, more like let the boobies hit the floor. You got a man's beast and a hose beast. The gore and the whore. And at the end, Jericho called Stephanie the breast. I mean the best. Good overall match here between Jericho and Rhino. Lots of Stephanie interference, eventually leading to Jericho forcing a kiss on her. Rhino controlled the majority of the match, but Jericho made his comeback. A failed gore led to a Walls of Jericho, and the match is over. Could have been better, but wasn't gonna be worse, as Chris Jericho defeated Rhino in 12 minutes, 34 seconds. Match number 5 was the third of 6 championship matches on the night. This one was a ladder match for the World Wrestling Federation Hardcore Championship. Champion Jeff Hardy of the WWF versus challenger Rob Van Dam of the Alliance. Jeff Hardy was in his second reign as Hardcore Champion, defeating Rob Van Dam on the August 13th, 2001 episode of Raw. These two stole the show at the Invasion pay-per-view the month prior, with RVD winning the Hardcore title. Then on the go-home episode of Raw during an RVD-Kurt Angle match, Hardy had his own referee. He came out, pinned Rob Van Dam for the belt because 24/7 rule. You get a ladder match here between these two, and I talked during my last episode about old-school ladder matches. This here is the furthest thing from one of those. But still, this was a fucking great ladder match between RVD and Jeff Hardy. Very even match, could have gone either way. For that time, you had some crazy spots by both guys. Both would miss their top rope finishers. There was one blown spot, though, but had it gone how it was supposed to, it would have been one of those all-time ladder match spots that people would try and replicate to this day. Jeff hangs on the ring holding the belt. RVD swings Jeff. RVD tries a diving kick from the top rope. He misses Jeff. Jeff then just falls for the sake of falling like he got hit. I'm not gonna fault them too much because that spot is hard as hell to execute, and RVD nearly did. He just missed Jeff by a little bit. So the match ended up finishing with Hardy climbing up the ladder, RVD pushing the ladder over, him climbing up, grabbing the Hardcore Championship. Post-match, you get a sign of respect when RVD and Hardy nodded to one another as Rob Van Dam defeated Jeff Hardy in 16 minutes, 33 seconds to win the WWF Hardcore Championship. Oh fucking joy. Match number 6. The 4th of 6 championship matches on the night. Second one for 2 titles. This one, a steel cage match for the WWF and WCW Tag Team Championships. WWF Tag Team Champions Diamond Dallas Page and WCW United States Champion Canyon of the Alliance versus WCW Tag Team Champions Undertaker and Kane of the WWF. Both teams were in their first reigns of their respective championships, and both teams won their belts during the August 7th SmackDown taping that aired on the 9th. Undertaker and DDP had been feuding for many months at this point, that whole stupid stalker angle. They brought in Canyon to be with DDP, and of course Kane to be with The Undertaker. Once DDP and Canyon won the WWF Tag Team titles, WWF Commissioner William Regal declared those two are now under WWF jurisdiction, and because of that, they were going to face Undertaker and Kane in a steel cage match at SummerSlam for the tag team titles. And when Undertaker and Kane won the WCW tag titles, that match became a double title match. Now, I hate the term burial because it gets used wrong all the fucking time by fans. However, if this here wasn't a burial, I don't know what the fuck is. This match, first off, fuck this match. This match here was 10 minutes of DDP and Canyon getting the ever-loving shit kicked out of them by The Undertaker and Kane. They let Canyon leave. Taker tells DDP to leave and he'll let him live, but Swerve, more of an ass-kicking. Undertaker hits DDP with the last ride. The match is over. This, one of the worst matches in SummerSlam history. Let's move on. Undertaker and Kane defeated DDP and Canyon in 10 minutes, 17 seconds to retain the WCW Tag Team titles and win the WWF Tag Team titles. In the penultimate match of the night, match number 7, you get the 5th of 6 championship matches on the night. This one was for the World Wrestling Federation Championship. Champion Steve Austin of the Alliance versus challenger Kurt Angle of the WWF. Steve Austin was in his 5th reign as WWF champion, defeating The Rock at WrestleMania 17. The month before at the Invasion pay-per-view, Steve Austin turned heel for the second time in 2001 when he defected to the Alliance after he attacked Angle and cost the WWF the inaugural brawl against the Alliance. The reason he joined the Alliance was because he felt Vince was setting Angle up to take his title, and that wasn't gonna happen. Now, we all know how stupid Austin's heel turns were in 2001 and how stupid it was for Austin to be a part of the Alliance. However, I can't hate this match too much. Kurt Angle versus Steve Austin from SummerSlam 01 is among the best matches in SummerSlam history. I'll go as far as saying it's one of the best matches either Austin or Angle ever had. Hell, as much as Austin hates his heel run in 01, he even puts this match over as being great. If you can look past the Invasion factor and just focus on the story of Steve Austin versus Kurt Angle, you had some great storytelling during this match. Angle kicked out of 3 Stone Cold Stunners, a rare feat at this point. Austin tries to intentionally get disqualified. However, no WWF referee would disqualify Austin, as that would mean the Alliance keeps the WWF title. Austin ended up attacking 3 WWF referees. Finally, Alliance referee Nick Patrick came down. Angle had the match won, but Patrick disqualified Austin for attacking the prior referees. Angle attacks Patrick post-match. This match was fantastic. If you've never seen it, check it out, as Kurt Angle defeated Steve Austin by disqualification in 22 minutes, 11 seconds, but Austin retains the WWF Championship. And with 7 matches down and 1 more match to go, it's time for the main event of SummerSlam 2001. Really shocking they went with this match to go last, but given the finish to the prior match, you wanted to send the fans home happy. This one was the 6th and final championship match of the night. This one was for the WCW Championship. Champion Booker T of the Alliance versus challenger The Rock of the WWF. Booker T was in his 5th reign as WCW Champion, defeating Kurt Angle on the July 30th, 2001 episode of Raw. The Rock returned in July from shoot movie making and kayfabe suspension. He's back with the WWF in the war against the Alliance, and the build for this match is famous for the WWF destroying any credibility the Alliance had left by destroying the credibility of WCW champion Booker T. Given the build and direction of this invasion angle, you knew Rock was winning this match here. In hindsight, they probably should have done Booker Angle rubber match for the WCW title and have the Austin Rock rematch for the WWF title. Also, in hindsight, they should have done a lot more with this angle, but hey, shit happens. But given the build-up to this match and the predictability of this match, Rock and Booker put on a solid main event here for SummerSlam. Shane with the interference, APA came out and attacked Shane, but eventually Shane recovered to interfere once again. Rock basically wins a handicap match here after he hits Booker with a rock bottom after Booker does the spin-a-rooney, as The Rock defeated Booker T in 15 minutes, 18 seconds to win the WCW Championship. You all know my thoughts on the invasion angle. I've talked about it many times in the past. That being said, with as much good as there was on this show, you really can't call SummerSlam 2001 a bad show. There was one truly bad thing on this night, and that was the cage match. But everything else here was solid to good, with an outstanding WWF title match and a great ladder match for the hardcore title. Had this show not taken place during the invasion, I think we would remember this show more fondly. At the very least, see this to say you've seen all the SummerSlams of the past. If you can put aside your hatred for the invasion, you'll probably enjoy this show. If you can't, at least see Austin Angle and RVD Hardy, because those were great, invasion or no invasion. But now it's time to give out some bells, the golden ring bell and the brown ring bell, for WWF SummerSlam 2001. I give the golden ring bell for best match to Steve Austin versus Kurt Angle, and I give the brown ring bell for worst match to Undertaker and Kane versus DDP and Canyon. So share your thoughts on SummerSlam 2001 in the comments section below. Ask questions about this show, and I'll answer them via reply. What do you think was the best and worst match on the night? And if you didn't already, was this the show where you lost all hope when it came to the invasion angle? Until next time, peace.
Since 2017, From the Vault has covered various wrestling topics from the past, like pay-per-views, wrestler retrospectives, and much, much more. Make sure to subscribe and click the notification bell. Whatever episodes you're actually listening to, whether current or archived, don't forget to like, comment, and share. And last but not least, like him on Facebook, follow him on Twitter. Be sure to support, because you will get tons of updates on future episodes there. All links are down below, so what are you waiting for? Go enjoy. Bye.